Hi, Florian. I'm Gigi. Hi.
Hello. Hello, Gigi.
Are you ready? Are you ready to do some modeling today, Florian?
I guess. Okay. Jesus Lord.
All right, Florian. I just need you to...
Very cold here.
Well, we need you to pretend it's not cold. We need you to be... You're going to be at a pool party.
Pretend?
Pretend. Like imagination, you know? We need happy... Think of things that make you happy, Florian. What makes you happy?
Home, Albania, 16th century.
Okay, well, now, right now you got to think of something. You're at a pool party. It's warm. It's hot.
Wagon's
you're
full
thirsty.
Of hay.
No, there's no hay anywhere. You're at a pool. It's beautiful. It's modern. It's Miami.
Pool.
And then
pool.
Suddenly your favorite. Yes, Ibiza. That's good. That's good.
Ibiza.
Oh, wow. You're good. Yes, you're happy. You know happy, right? Happy?
No. This is happy face.
Okay, well, try to smile a little more. Just happy smile.
You
okay.
Like teeth? I go to Max Clinic.
You look like you're just trying to take a poop. I need to smile. It's fine.
I am.
Can you just pretend, though, you're at this pool party and your favorite song comes on. Florian, what's your favorite song? React to your favorite song, Florian. What's your favorite?
Cotton Eye Joe by Rednecks.
Okay. All right.
Yes, that's it. Where did you come from?
All right, we're just imagining the song comes on. People are watching you. You look European and now happy. You still have that pooping look.
So I get job.
You know what? You're hired. You're hired. Everybody else can leave.
How much money you pay me? How much money?
$150 for a half day of work. You're going to meet a guy out in the alley of a 7-Eleven.
This fucking shit.
Ready, Stace? Ready, Darce? Here we go. It's our big hit, Twins.
Sisters, sisters, there were never such devoted sisters.
Stacey is the one who's always got my back.
Yeah, Darcy's love life, that's a lot to unpack.
True.
Caring, sharing, every little thing that we are wearing.
House of 11, we've had lots of guy trouble, that's well known.
I've got a fiancé, and she's alone.
Wow.
All kinds of weather, we stick together, the same in the rain or sun. We've got tight faces, but in tight places, we think and we act as one.
Take it, Darce.
Manifest our twin power.
Scoot-a-ba-ba-dee-ba-ha-da.
The twins. Up-a-da-ba. Hat-da-ga. Ooh, my boobs shake when I do that. Ooh. Hoo-ha.
The new star of Darcy and Stacey, ladies
right?
and gentlemen.
Someone has found their footing.
Well, because someone needed to get a fucking job, and he knew he needed to make sure he was on season five.
I think... I can't imagine what his favorite song is. But at one point he says, in general, I don't dance.
Don't dance. Like, he doesn't... When she said, what makes you happy? And I went, nothing. Nothing makes him happy. He's never happy.
Village Square.
Like.
Young maiden who exposed his neck and I saw blood.
Basically. You know, he was. Well, did you see how hungry he was at that dinner?
Stacey said, you haven't eaten all day. He's like, shrimp. Shrimp.
You didn't see it though. Because, okay, as Sissy told us and reminded me, I spent about. Y'all, it only took me like 30 minutes today. I watched all the extras of Darcy and Stacey.
Oh, I need...
Oh. Oh, you said that like, what's her name? I need a Libra man.
I need a Libra man.
You are really just one cabin in the woods away from Edie.
Oh, I am. I take that as a badge of honor.
I take that as a...
My voice needs to get better because I can't do Florian.
It's a... Well, I'm still a little hoarse from Vegas and from the strippers. So what are you going to do? But what I was going to say is...
did you see when they just made up their own song? That one?
So, yes, that's...
Someone
they
sent
made up their
me.
Own song. There's one where we find out that Darcy puts maxi pads under her breasts so her breasts don't sweat. And they talk all about it and show us the clip. There's another one, too, where they just, for this episode, they just showed Florian sitting down and ordering all the food and eating all the food and Darcy being disgusted by it. And he was just ravenous eating. And I went, well, it's because his iron's low, because his blood's got sucked out of him.
Yeah, he needs iron. And it's weird because he used to be a vampire, and now Stacy takes all of his blood.
Yes, that's true. There's an extra for Darcy with Aniko and Aspen of when they're talking about going prom shopping. And Darcy talks about their prom dresses versus Aniko and Aspen's. And
why are these left on the cutting room floor?
I don't know, because there's not enough time. I make this show an hour and a half. I'm here for it. And then there's also Darcy looks at Aspen. She's like, Aspen, you'd be friends with me in high school, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you? And she's like, you're kind of intense, Mom. And she's like, you would, right? And then Aspen, she looks at Aspen, she's like, you'll be friends, right? And Aspen says, yeah, Mommy. She's like, yeah, you'll be friends with Mommy, you'll be friends with him. And then Aniko says, but what if she like came up to you like during lunch period and she's like, you know how she gets and she's all talking at you? And Aspen's like, oh, it's just joy. Anyway, I highly recommend them. They're really... The song that they made up was epic.
It was kind of like to the top. Like, go get to the top. Yeah. And at one point, Stacey just went, oh! And it was just so awful.
And then they finished.
They're like, higher!
Yes. And then they sit down, and Darcy just goes, oh, boy. It was really...
Someone sent it to me. I did not look at it. And I laughed like a fool, like my head back.
It's a good 30 minutes. You'll enjoy it. Y'all, it's on Darcy and Stacey on Discovery Plus is where you can see all the extras. I think they might show some on the social media. But right now, this is Darcy and Stacey. We're talking about season 4, episode 8. What's the title, Poodle?
Roasted and Ghosted.
Roasted and Ghosted.
You can get your hash browns roasted and ghosted at the Waffle House.
It's true. I think there was a Waffle House sketch in Saturday Night Live this weekend.
I didn't watch it.
My friend Punky was talking about it.
I don't watch that show anymore.
I very rarely do. And I realized my friend Punky, who I did a pilot with and have done stand-up with,
she's been on it
for like a year and a half. She and I both were cast in a pilot for a new Tom Arnold reality show. This is about 10 years ago. Did you know this?
No, I didn't. But wow.
Oh, yeah. It was a full-on pilot for a reality show, a Tom Arnold reality show, and Tom Arnold was like running this like club, and they picked some restaurant Was I what?
The gay assistant.
Ding 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 ding. Yeah, I was.
That's who I would have guessed you as.
I was Tom's gay assistant that Tom treated like shit. And the weirdest thing about the whole thing, there was no production value. Anyway, it was at a restaurant. The restaurant was literally working in the front, and they still wouldn't give us food from the restaurant to eat. Like, we literally just got fucking craft services. But I can't believe I never told the story. Tom Arnold, he was nice when he was on set. He was fine. Tom Arnold stayed in his car, the outside and back, because there was no trailer or anything for him. He stayed in his car the entire time with the air conditioning on when he wasn't shooting.
I would do that.
It was like a 90 degree day in Los Angeles. Anyway, Punky played the bouncer. And
she's actually funny on the show. I just kind of stopped watching it.
We had a great, great improv together. It was a lot of fun. And shockingly, it never got picked up.
And then you played the gay assistant on something else.
They wanted me, the same production company wanted me to be the gay assistant for that Leanne Rimes, Eddie Cibrian show.
Y'all, you just keep doing what you're doing.
Just keep doing what you're doing. I know. So, but they wanted me really be really bitchy and gay, and that's just not me.
It's more me.
It is. But even when I try to be fake bitchy, it doesn't work. It's inauthentic.
Whenever I would go out for those judges on singing competition things,
judges.
I would be the expert slot, the Randy Jackson slot. And I was always a little too bitchy for that. But
they always realized you were more the Simon Cowell.
Yeah, I didn't really fit the mold that they wanted. And like I said, the slots where every time I would get cast and I would see it, it was a black woman in my spot. And I was like, okay, go for it, honey.
Good
but
for them.
Hardly did any of them ever get made.
Well, one day, I still think that's when you're going to get fame. How's your Big Brother audition coming?
I'm working on it.
All
right. I didn't go to the casting call because the guy I was talking to said that it wasn't the best idea to do it.
Okay, good. Well, we won't say any more about it then.
We shouldn't. We can talk stuff off air.
Y'all, I will say this. We have a relationship with Netflix and we're very glad. We can't say anything except for after this, we are both recapping the first episode of Love is Blind.
Holy and shit.
It was fantastic. That first episode. It was,
I agree. I agree. I can't, I want to say so much now.
We can't say, but we'll just tell you all, get the fuck ready. It's so good.
It is. And it's different this season. It's a different feel.
We'll get sued.
Okay. That was nothing. That was nothing.
But you were going to elaborate on why it's different. You I could see it in your eyes. You wanted to say one thing.
Maybe. Who would have thought that they had Cocaine Bear on this season?
Who knew? Look, he was looking for love and a dealer.
Yeah.
Any other announcements, Pood? We've got Everything in the World coming back soon. So we've talked about Love is
Blind.
The
world's coming back. Me, you, and my ex in April on the cringe tier. Also on the cringe tier, Seeking Brother Husband.
Yep.
The cringe tier is going to be lit. That's the $8 tier, if you're wondering what that is.
It is
and also,
going to be
life
lit.
After lockup is going to keep going.
It just never ends.
Let's jump into
too.
This. Let's jump into
let's
this.
Do it. Jump into this.
We're
okay.
Making the otherwise known as Darcy doing ordinary things that goes haywire, which I demand in every episode.
It's like they listened to you. You literally said last episode, I would watch her, just love watching her make a sandwich.
Yeah.
And this was great. Yeah. Oh.
And y'all, it's a mess.
Smoothie goes everywhere. It's a big mess.
It's George Jetson every time he's trying to do something technological. Jane, get me off this crazy thing.
Wow.
What?
For any of you under the age of
35, people grew up with the Jetsons, didn't they? They were on Cartoon Network.
I don't know why. I've never seen an episode of the Jetsons.
Really?
I never watched. I saw it on, but I never watched. But I don't think it's still on, is it?
Felt like it was too elitist for you. It wasn't. There weren't enough cowboys and pitchforks.
Maybe. I just never. I really like the theme song. I just never. Maybe I watched an episode too. I just don't remember ever really getting into it. I was very big.
I wanted a robot maid.
Yeah.
Why haven't they done yet?
Why haven't they done a remake of the Jetsons?
No, a robot maid.
Oh,
Rosie.
Well, they should.
I want a robot maid. There's a Roomba, but y'all, my Roomba can only do so much.
So we're going to talk about Darcy and Stacey, and then after the commercial, we're going to do a quick little, because we know you're going to ask, we're going to do a quick little Oscar takes, because this is airing the day after Oscars aired.
Yeah.
So it gives you something to look forward to. But so Darcy's sitting there, she's making a smoothie, she's like, I can't relax last night. Georgia called me three times. early in the morning. I'm sleeping. You know, Darcy does not get up early. She is not
10 a.m. He called it 10 a.m. and she's like, bleary-eyed.
I still care about you and I still love you.
And then she basically says, I don't know if I can trust Florian anymore because he told Georgie about her personal life. And they're going to a gallery opening. And so then Florian and Georgie are meeting. And it's this weird moment of meeting for coffee. And Florian says, you fucked up so much last night.
What the fuck are you doing? When he said that.
I don't believe it.
Florian, so Georgie is like, well, what can I do? I see the diamonds and they shine beautifully like her. And I go, ooh, diamonds, Darcy.
Georgie, you can all be my best man. I may be better for Darcy.
That's fucked up. I just see why. I see sparkly and diamond boobies. I want boobies, Darcy.
Listen to me next time. Listen.
Florian acts like he really came up with the greatest grand master plan or whatever ever.
It was not it was not the big heist from the movie Heat. It wasn't the sting. It was simple getting them together and for him to say I'm sorry to Darcy, and Georgie flubbed it.
He flubbed it. I should watch this thing. I love movies where people rob stuff.
It's a good movie. It's an older movie, but it's a good movie.
Isn't that where they play the entertainer?
Yes, that is the entertainer is the main theme of the movie.
All right.
But yeah, it's kind of like a switcheroo.
Oh, and Paul Newman's in that, right? He's hot.
Paul Newman and Robert Redford.
Robert Redford.
My mother showed it to me.
Well, that was nice. Jay Bird, you got to watch this movie.
Come on, two favorite actors. He's so hot.
Your father used to look like him. He doesn't anymore.
She never would say that. Ooh, he's so sexy.
Did you tell your mother that Rod Stewart, or no, that Air Supply is playing out at the Hollywood Bowl?
I didn't yet. I need to tell her that.
I'm telling y'all, I've told Poodle, I'm like, you need to invite your mom out to Air Supply. And he's like, I don't want to do that. And I said, no, you need to invite her because then she won't come. And then she'll be talking about for like 6 months. Well, that's so sweet of you to invite me, but
she'll tell all her friends too. Yeah.
Jay Bird invited me out. He was going to invite me out to Los Angeles to Air Supply. Isn't that so sweet? I'm not going to go. Can't leave Muffin.
Can't get a box seat there for Muffin, apparently. Hollywood.
Tell her, I'll watch Muffin. Tell her I'll watch the dog while you're gone.
You couldn't handle Muffin. I'm going to say that now.
Can you imagine your mother traveling on a plane with Muffin?
No, absolutely not. Muffin, get out of that guy's crotch. No, that wouldn't work. So we are at the gallery opening for Leslie, their fake friend.
Well, hold on. We should say Florian says Georgie can't be his best man anymore.
Oh, I said that, but it was in a weird Florian voice, so you might not have heard it.
Oh, I did not understand. Yeah, I just heard it.
Yes, he said he told Georgie that.
You cannot be this man.
That's fucked up.
So it looks like I'm thinking we're not going to have any more Georgie until possibly the reunion.
Yeah.
And then you know he's going to be there or the tell-all.
If there's a reunion or tell-all.
There should be. They had one last year. It's the first
That's
one.
True.
It'd be weird for them not.
But don't you agree this Leslie person's a fake friend? Like, they don't know her.
They don't know her, 100%. I will say, she is, there's a thing with her, mention of her in the extras a little bit more.
Oh, okay. I just feel like, I don't feel like there's any capital between them.
No.
So the who's who of Miami at this gallery opening?
In the extras, too, we talk about, we missed it, but Stacy totally pitches Florian as a model for this Russian artist.
Oh, no.
And she's like, where have you done, what, where have you done work? Where have you done work? Have you, where have you modeled commercially? And Florian's like,
no.
And he's kind of just standing there. And Stacey's like, well, he's modeled for us, for House of 11.
Wow. So y'all, Darcy, she said, they tried to call Darcy, but to tell her we're sorry, but she didn't pick up the phone. So y'all, Stacey's like, you know, Florian's sorry. It wasn't his fault. So she's really switched since the last time.
Yes.
And Darcy shows up, y'all, completely ignores Stacey and Florian. It's very junior high at this point.
It is, but at the same time, I'm kind of enjoying, I'm enjoying Darcy. I feel like Darcy's taking some of her power back. She's going to give it right away, y'all, but she's taking her power back.
Well, and that's what I think. I don't think either sister can really do that. When they do fight, it gets junior high. They do things. So I agree with you, but neither of them have good enough boundaries not to not fight petty. Unfortunately.
Yeah.
So yeah. I see it as less powerful than you do.
I guess I'm talking about powerful, though, like later on, not with Stacey so much as with...
With Florian, it's different, though.
With Florian and Georgie, I'm really proud of Dart. Like, we had a meme last week from this episode of Darcy kind of telling him, of our theater, of Darcy telling him off. And all of y'all were so, as we were impressed with Darcy, was just like, fuck you, no, I'm done.
I totally agree with you about Georgie. And getting Florian to...
Stacey's a different thing. Yes.
With her sister, she's... No. So they're basically looking at the model, and they're explaining this. He's like, yes, the model is like mother. Mother to animal. It's like a cat holding...
Alien lips. It's like...
Aliens sucking on boobs.
Sucking on boobs. Ha!
How do you do that?
How do you do that?
You got cat like alien milk.
It's rough. I don't like cats.
And then all of a sudden, some queen in a white jacket pulls Leslie away. It looks like the queen in Beetlejuice.
Otho. That's Otho. What I was going to say. Otho. Yes, it was Otho. Otho completely.
Excuse me. We need to go. Leslie has to be somewhere.
God, I would. Oh, y'all, there are few queens like Otho.
I know. And that queen was a queen before people were queening. That's true. that queen walked so a lot of queens could run.
It's true. I wonder what happened to that actor.
That actor's still around. That actor played a preening queen in everything. That really? Would have been us.
Well, oh, you look up. Glenn. Oh, Glenn Shaddix. He's dead.
No.
Yeah,
he
died in 2010 at the age of 58. He was, of course, he's Southern. He was originally from Alabama.
Only 58. Oh no, like that's awful.
Oh, he was in the Groundlings. That's why he was so funny. Shocking. He came out as gay at the age of 17.
Sometimes I don't think you have to come out.
Wow, listen to this. After spending 30 years in Los Angeles in 2007, he moved to his native Bessemer, Alabama, where he purchased a Queen Anne-style Victoria-era home.
Stop it!
Yep. The house was completely destroyed in a fire in December of 2008, and Shaddix told reporters, I have lost my dream.
Southern story is insane.
Oh, wow. He died. He died in 2010, just 2 years later after he lost his dream because he fell in the kitchen at his condominium in Birmingham, Alabama, and died of blunt trauma to the head because he was already in a wheelchair. So had he not got his house not burned down, he never would have had to go into that condo, and he probably wouldn't have fallen down and beat his head, and that was why he died.
We need to move on.
That was really bleak.
Because I'm really bummed.
That's really shitty.
Rest in peace, Glenn / Otho.
Wow.
Sorry. Southern stories are sad. So I love, what did you think about, so the artist leaves and Darcy's just like, well, I'm still in my feelings. And I don't blame her because the thing, you know, the producers asked her earlier, do you trust Florian now? And she's like, I don't know. Because this is true. Florian has just been telling Georgie everything about Darcy.
No, I think Darcy has a good point here.
So well, Darcy,
like, was this your plan? Were you in cahoots? And Florian no, it was not in fucking cahoots.
He doesn't even know what that means.
But, I know in fucking cahoots.
Darcy pulls a baller move and says, well, let's just call him right now. Just call him and I need you to tell him that.
Call him out. Call him out.
No more information for me right now. And you see George or Florian kind of freeze. And he does not.
I never do this in my life. It is, but it is a little weird. I think I do see why it's strange to do it in front of Darcy. And I think what Florian objected to is that there were two other people listening in the call. It wasn't the fact that he had to call Georgie. It was doing it right now on speakerphone.
Well, but Darcy doesn't trust him.
Right.
So he calls because he calls. And guess what? The first thing Georgie says is,
did Darcy ask about me? Is she talking to...
And Darcy's like, see, there you go. There you go.
And Florian's like, you need to move on. Big move on. Big move on. Not just move on. Big move on.
That's the reboot. Stop worrying what you're doing. Big move
on.
Big
move on. What did you... We both saw that production. What did you think about it? I had a lot of thoughts. This is that pair. We went to the Pasadena Playhouse. I had more of a problem with her.
I was going to say, you got to like Dot if you're going to go see Sunday in the Park with George.
She was so cold.
She also breathed through her nose a lot for singing, and it bothered me as a
Yeah, we're talking about this Sunday in the Park with George at the Pasadena Playhouse.
I like George a lot. I liked him quite a bit.
He was fantastic. That was the kid from The Good Wife, Graham Phillips.
He was really good. But her, I felt like she was trying to Sarah Bareilles Dot.
You said it correctly. Dot needs to be the most likable person on the stage. And everyone else needs to feel kind of stiff and uninteresting.
You don't believe. Why would this guy who's an artist who doesn't want to really love anyone anyway, why would he fall even in love with her?
She also needs to be throwing herself at him.
Yeah.
And that's just...
You and I know what that looks like.
Yes. I'm aware. Yeah. And then
I am a Dot.
And then I felt like there were, even though I knew a lot of big names on that stage, I also got claustrophobia with so many people on that fucking stage. It was too many people on that tiny stage.
I went with our friend who was a director, and she said there was a lot.
Lindsay.
Yeah, she said there was a lot of standing and almost let's make space instead of intentional movement.
I agree. It's no wonder that the daughter of the book writer was the director, Sarna Lapine. My biggest issue was that the supporting cast, which of which there are a lot, came off like bad community theater actors. Like some, they were trying to like the couple from like Texas. I'm like,
they were very big.
This is not, it's, even though it's comedy, it's got subtlety to it. It was a medium production. I really liked him.
He was fantastic.
Yeah. And I liked the woman who played Yvonne, but that was like it. Go see Sunday in the Park with George. That's Jules's wife. That was the other painter's wife.
Oh, I liked her. And I liked the mother.
Yeah, she was good. Liz Larson, she sang her song well. she was trying to find humor in different places that there normally are, there aren't there. And I liked some of the choices and I didn't like others. But I know the show. This is like the first time I've seen it. But this
we
is the
really
first
shouldn't
time
talk about it because only like 20 of you could go see this. The rest of you don't live in Pasadena or even remotely close.
But it's not going to tour. But it was similar to the Jake Gyllenhaal, Anna Lee Ashford production that was on Broadway. She directed that too, but that was on a big stage.
Yeah, it was a little. Yeah. It's
very anyway, cool. Sorry, we had to talk about that. We didn't have to. I wanted to.
Yeah, you wanted to.
So
basically, he hangs up the phone and Darcy says, thank you. I needed to hear it. But it's going to take time on my end. And that's when I wrote, good for Darcy. I actually thought, just good for her when it's coming.
No. This was.
Well, I was going to say, sometimes you can't stand in your power in every aspect of your life because sometimes it's too hard because with familiar relationships or whatever. It's just there's way too much more kind of emotional. There's too much of an emotional map to wade through to get to that. But it's a really good sometimes if you can't have boundaries with some people, with all people in your life, what if you have boundaries with some people? And the fact that she's able to do this with Georgie and Florian is great.
The main issue I have here is we don't really know how to feel because we didn't see the breakup. Yes. And it's very frustrating to me that if you're going to be quiet about it, don't film him later.
I hope it comes out in the tell all.
Yeah. I just find it the fact that we don't know yet, I think we would totally empathize with what Darcy was saying. Or we could understand that nothing was set between them. We don't know the situation. We don't know how they broke up.
I could see Darcy saying, or seeing Sean Robinson saying, what happened? What? I would think she would ask that.
Just a lot of things. Just a lot of things.
Well, we wish you the best.
I just don't know if it was filmed or not.
No, I don't think it was filmed. At least we find out what happened, at least.
Yeah. Anyway.
Y'all, we're going to take a little break, and when we're right back, we're going to talk about the Academy Awards briefly and then get back to Darcy and Stace.
It's gays on the Oscars. You think you want to hear what the gays have to say about the Oscars? Because there's kind of like the gay Super Bowl.
And after we're done, you'll say that didn't really help me at all.
No, no.
But we'll have fun.
I don't think a lot of our segments are helpful.
No, I don't think so. Overall, though, we both were talking a little bit before. One of my friends, Don, said this, and what a kind Oscars. I thought it was a great ceremony. I really enjoyed it.
I really liked it. I think it's, I love Jimmy Kimmel. I think he's got the right amount of bite to talk about how stupid this whole event is, you know, to kind of keep some perspective. But
I thought he did real well because you got to make jokes about last year.
Yeah.
And even though I love that he didn't even let it go, even at the very end of the Oscars, when it was like one Oscars, one day without incident, that was so funny to me. It was so funny.
There were some really good jokes. I think the speeches were great. I was kind of a lot of times there. Yeah. Everything, everywhere, I always get it wrong. It's everywhere, everything, all at once. EEAO.
I can't sit here and watch you work it out.
But I was so happy it won. I saw it in theaters like a long time ago because everyone was saying you have to go see this. Who I trust was saying you have to see this in theaters. You have to see this in theaters And it blew me away. I wasn't sure I fully understood it by the first time through. And then I watched it again. And I was like, oh, I noticed a lot more things. But I loved it. And
I didn't see anything that was presented. I was just there to watch the celebrities. I'm one of those, y'all. But I think that's the beauty of it. You can
Watch the Oscars if you watch or not.
You really should see Everything Everywhere All at Once.
No, I'm going to. I'm a superhero, Brad. So I have it as one of my SAG screeners. So I think now you can screen it. But that's what I love about the Oscars. That's why it is the gay Super Bowl.
Yeah. Because
you can watch it if you know about the movies, you can. Or if you're just a fair weather person that just wants to watch people you love and see Harrison
Ford.
Dress
pretty.
And that little kid from Raiders of the Lost Ark who grew the fuck up.
And they hugged on stage.
You can see all
of
that.
I love that moment. I love Michelle Yeoh winning and talking about her mom. And I feel like a lot of it was all spread around pretty well. I mean, EEAAO won a lot of
won a lot. There's people that are pissed about Angela Bassett that wish that she would have won still for Wakanda Forever. But
think about it this way. Angela Bassett didn't lose. Jamie Lee Curtis just won. Just because you didn't win doesn't make you a loser.
But it's a really, people are saying robbed. I've seen that. I think though.
Again, I think that's a negative way of thinking about it.
I agree. I'm just telling you what's kind of like what
I know. I've
people's
seen that
feelings
too.
About it.
I've seen that too.
I don't. She was great in that film, but I think she's given better performances. So in other things, in better movies, I don't think Wakanda Forever was as good as. I wanted it to be a little better. I'm mad they killed her, honestly. I hope they bring the character back. But that's a Maddie comic book minute, not a Oscars Academy Award moment.
Probably smart.
Yes.
I just never like to be... I guess, to me,
go ahead, sorry.
When someone wins, to disparage a winner because someone else lost... is not fair, I feel
I
like.
Think you're coming from it from the... I agree with you, but I also think you're coming from it from a different perspective than a lot of other people in that you are a creator and you an art artist. So, like, you and I both recognize that the whole thing of the Oscars is just... is ridiculous and stupid anyway because art is subjective and there's never winners and losers in art.
No.
But a lot of people aren't artists, so they don't see it that way. They feel like, that person was the best. I'm like, no. No, just enough people
from the Academy voted.
Because how do you compare a performance like The Whale to what's his name in Elvis? That was like a complete like embodiment of a person.
I hated The Whale. I hated that film. It was like a horror movie, and it treated like an obese person as a freak. And
that's
honestly
why I didn't want to watch it.
Now, his performance, fantastic. It was, I could divorce the performance from the movie. I hated that movie. I was really happy to say one of my most exciting moments of the night was Sarah Polley winning for Women Talking for Best Adapted Screenplay, because that was probably one of my favorite movies of the year. And
you did enjoy that
movie. I was so happy she won that because I wanted to see that film get recognized.
What did you think of the a best song? Are you glad the song won?
I'm glad. Yes, it's definitely the most. Part of me thinks we should just kick that category to the curb. I know that's a horrible thing to say. Like,
then who would perform what?
True. That Lady Gaga song is a snooze. That song and that Diane Warren song.
I was gonna say that Lady Gaga song's way better than that Diane Warren song. And that's
and I don't even love. I also feel like that. I understand that people are thinking it almost like a hymn to Chadwick Boseman, but even the Rihanna song doesn't do a whole lot for me.
No, she has a lot better. She has other songs that are so much better.
Yeah, it's
I'm underwhelmed by all the best songs.
RRR win. I think that categories become kind of a joke.
I agree with that.
Yeah. And I don't know.
Have you ever seen the speech that Bette Midler gave when she was presenting Best Song?
No.
I just saw it on Instagram, and it's really, this is years ago. And I think she was still bitter because I think either The Rose was nominated, but it didn't win.
Oh,
and
That's a song from a show.
Maybe it did win. But anyway, it's a really good little, it's on the Instagram and the TikTok. All right, we're almost done. Did you see the interview though? Of the red carpet with Hugh Grant. Being a dickhead.
What a dick!
What an asshole!
He was so
mean to Ashley Madison. That's not fair.
I think it's Ashley Graham.
Ashley Madison
is the website where people go to have affairs.
Oh, okay. Ashley Graham. Who was your best dressed?
You know, I had a couple. I loved Angela Bassett in that purple number.
Mm-hmm.
I loved all the white. There was a lot of white gowns.
Jessica Chastain's was my favorite of the night.
Oh, that was nice.
That white, I think it was black, but when she turned around, I actually think it was a dark green, maybe.
Yeah, that was a nice dress.
I liked that dress, and I also enjoyed, I actually enjoyed Lady Gaga's black dress. That was really beautiful.
Yeah, the thing about—
I didn't like her makeup.
A lot of black dresses, if you need to go full— I think you need to go full creative with something. Otherwise, all those black dresses just look better in a different color. They look more exciting in a different color. I think if you're going to wear black, it either needs to be super accented or be super couture and have something to say. And I didn't think that Lady Gaga dress had as much to say as she could. It's fucking Lady Gaga.
I liked it.
I'm not telling you shouldn't like it.
I worst dressed. I don't remember. I don't know. I don't know who. There was nobody that I was like. It just felt like a very good Oscars, but also a very kind of safe Oscars. Like everyone was on their best behavior, best
fashion.
You know what
I hated, and this is a little weird. I hated the salmon kind of orangey pink tux jacket that The Rock was wearing because it looked like it was cheap material. And it didn't blend it in with the background, and it didn't look good. I was just bitchy about it. I don't know why.
I was noticing his arms. I barely paid attention, but you're right. I do remember seeing it. It's that satin, that kind of pulls.
Yes, and it looks like a No Mazza special.
I felt for Christian Siriano. His office, I follow him on Instagram, they flooded 2 days before the Oscars.
Oh, no.
They had a pipe burst. There was a huge flood, and they had to get everything there.
Who was the woman who was wearing a black thing, a black dress, and there was like a cutout? And I remember thinking, God, that's so ugly. I can't remember.
I don't know.
But I don't know. I didn't see anything that I was just like horrified. Oh, wait. I'm trying to think. I love Elizabeth Banks. I love Elizabeth Banks.
Mm-hmm.
She was wearing a mess. Like when the Cocaine Bear came out and they were doing a bit, she could barely hold on to that dress.
She could. That wasn't great.
It was
great.
A mess. And I love her.
I forgot. Oh, Angela Bassett's dress was really, really pretty.
It was such a great color. It had volume to it. Yeah, I really like that dress.
Yeah, it was really pretty. Oh, you know who thought, I don't really love her eyebrows a lot, but when she walked out, I gasped because the slit was perfect. Cara, can't say her last name, Delevingne.
Delevingne, yeah.
I loved her dress.
I liked her too. She's a cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, but I enjoyed her dress.
Yeah. And you know what? I don't know how you're going to feel about this. I feel like I'm going to make you upset because I know you love her so much.
Say it.
You know, I'm not going to say it. Let's just move on.
Yeah, you are. Yep. Say it. Say it.
Michelle Williams looked like somebody's dowdy grandma.
I did not like it. She She has a lot of wins and a lot of losses in the dress thing. She hits some misses.
I didn't love it.
Yeah. I don't know.
I think best tux actually was Michael B. Jordan because he had the double breasted Tux when he came out. And that was sweet how, as a comic book nerd, he called her, he walked out and he called Angela Bassett auntie.
Hey, auntie, yeah. Well, and also Jonathan Majors were like, hey, we love you. Right after Jamie Lee Curtis had won. Yeah, that was nice because you could tell she was upset.
Yeah, she did have, I think, the look of the night where she looked.
And it's tough, you know. You were
Jamie Lee Curtis
work,
even said she was like, "You're fucking pissed when you lose."
So I mean, it sucks. I just wish we didn't turn this into Team A and Team B. You know what I mean? I agree with you, but I just think
that's not what the whole point of the Oscar sets up. It's meant to celebrate film, but by making it a competition, it's actually then taking away. But
it's actually not a competition in a way. But
the way the Academy's awards, it sets up. If it's not a competition, then people wouldn't spend 2 months going around and courting all the board and voters.
I totally agree, but it's not a competition like a sports competition. And I think that's the way people approach it. And if someone wins, it means that someone was robbed and there's an injustice.
I think that's part of what the Academy Awards did. They set it up almost like a sports competition. My favorite Oscars to this day. Something's beeping. Someone's backing up.
Yeah, we hear it.
my favorite Oscars was the one where all the nominees went on stage. Remember that? It was like 10 years. They all went on stage and all the nominees introduced the other actor. And they talked about, like all the women for Best Actress would talk about the male for Best Actor and what they appreciated about their performance. It was
nice. That was nice.
I think it was a very long Oscars and people got pissed, but I liked it.
Like this show's about to be.
I like that they had all it's true. You wanted to talk about Sunday in the Park with George. I wanted to talk about this.
We talked about it for 5 minutes.
It was not Gary. Roll that. I just want to say this. I do like that they had all the categories back.
Yeah, I agree. It did feel better.
It did.
It's interesting. There's so many awards programs and there's so many, and it did feel like things got spread around. So, I was really glad that EEOOA took on everything. But there was an Oscar and they had a name EEOOA.
You're right. This has gone on too long.
A-O. It's a E-E-A-A-O.
Yep, too long. You're right. You were right.
Moving on.
Okay, let's go look at wedding venues with Florian Stacey. Okay, this venue is gorgeous. I loved it.
The Harbor House?
I thought it was perfect. I thought it's nice.
Feel the vibe.
It looks, like she said, it has this beach quality. It doesn't feel ostentatious. It doesn't feel like you're at like something schmarmy trying to be really rich. It just felt really quaint and charming to me.
You could tell it was expensive as fuck, too. Like
$40,000 is not a lot of money.
I guess so. All inclusive.
She said, now it's whatever she said. Look. For Miami, $40,000 is not a lot of money at all.
I guess so. It's a lot of money to everybody who lives outside of Miami, though.
I agree, but I'm just telling sissies that people that live in Los Angeles, New York, Chicago, they watched this and went, only $40,000 for that wedding?
Like, no, it's true. Crazy. I don't. Is that just for the venue? That's what I was wondering.
That's what I was going to say. She said for, quote, everything. But I'm like, does that include the meal?
There's
the DJ,
no way.
The band? Like, there's no way. No way. Of course, Florian has a problem with the venue anyway because thinks it's ugly.
No, someone's being a little groomzilla about things. This in need more love. Dick, I wish do not exist. Being a little bitch.
Yeah.
And he's like, no, it's not worth it for me. I don't think
Florian, you're not paying for anything anyway. You're not paying for it. Doesn't matter.
She throws it down. She's like, it's my money. Get a job if you want to have an opinion. Put your money where your mouth is. We're making an executive decision.
The executive.
She's like, we're booking it. And Florian goes, executive decision.
That poor woman standing there was just kind of like, okay. Got
I'm
another
sure
showing
she's,
in 10
she's
minutes.
Seen fights at that time.
Come at us, sissy wedding planners or sissy event. How many fights have they seen of just brides and grooms or brides and brides or grooms and grooms just fighting?
I don't think I would ever want that job. It seems too way too house stress for me.
Probably would be a stressful job. But Stacey says, I made it. She said executive decision. She makes a decision. She stomps off, and that's where they're having the wedding, y'all.
Darcy and Anaquin Aspen, they are looking for last-minute things for the dorm room. And she's like, gotta have your shower shoes. Gonna be showering in a public bathroom. 1,600 people in one bathroom? What?
Yeah.
A lot of pee in the shower.
Like a lot of people. I pee in the shower.
Yeah. COVID, we didn't have toilet paper.
Had to.
And then she's like, you need a paperweight for all your papers when you're turning them in. Mom, I do all my work on computer. You graduated high school 30 years ago. She's like, No, I didn't.
What are you talking about? 30 years ago. And then Anaquin actually says the date and explains it. And that's where Poodle went, oh, God. I almost graduated high school 30 years ago because that's what I did too.
Yep. She graduated in like 1992 or something like that.
She's 48 and we're 40. I'm 44 now.
And I'm 45. And you're
44. By the way, y'all, thank you for all the birthday messages. Even Poodles did a little. It was very sweet. I appreciated it. I felt the love. I had a wonderful birthday. And also.
Well, it's gone.
It's gone now. I was reminded that not only is Kim Bali share the same birthday as me, but Lindsay from Love After Lockup is a
quote from a book.
She's a March 12th baby too. I'm like, this is so exciting. Kimberly sent me a she sent me a message.
Shut up.
No, she did. She's saying like happy birthday, and I said happy birthday to you. I said 2023, it's gonna be about me and it's gonna be about you. I said. I got dickmatized, but not anymore. And she messaged you back. She was like, yeah, me too. I got yammy-tized.
Yammy-tized.
The potential. So I kind of think now Kimberly and I are friends.
Wow.
I would hang out with her in San Diego. I think it would be fun.
I think now she gets it more. And if they were smart, she'll be on The Single Life.
Oh, yes.
If they're smart, she'll be on The Single Life. Because, y'all, those dates are going to be messy.
They are.
She'll probably walk out, throw a couple drinks. Jamal will be there to calm her down. Anyway.
Now, Darcy doesn't get anything for her Anaquin for school, but she does tell them that she saw a picture with Cicero.
With another woman. Cicero Lipschitz.
Thank you. Kind of Cicero. Around the time that she...
Lipschitz. He had it coming.
Yeah, I knew you had to get it out. No, don't...
Not pop. Chewing. Popping.
I want to tell you this right now. There's a lot of things I get bored about when you go on about things as you do me. But don't you ever apologize on our show for singing Candor and
singing... Cell Block Tango.
Don't you ever apologize. I'm always here for that.
And on his way, he said we divorced because of autistic differences. I saw him as alive. He saw himself as alive, and I saw him as dead. The dirty bum, 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 bum. Oh, God, those are drag queen monologues. which I taught young girls to do.
Yeah, at summer camp. You did. At summer camp, you did.
I'm like, stop doing this. I'm just going to give you a line read. Do it like I'm doing it.
Sometimes if I just need to get inspired as an actor or artist or singer, I'll just watch that movie because it's so perfect.
Yeah, they're living in exactly the right way. It's a shame. 12-year-old girls just don't know how to deliver those monologues.
Shocking. Shocking. Golly.
You need to hit popping more.
Yeah, and can you, when I saw it at the Palisades High School because my goddaughter goes there.
Yeah.
And the year before they did, what's the thing with what's her name? Who's the funny girl who's...
Spring Awakening.
They did Spring Awakening, yes, yeah. With Leah Remini. And so, or no, Leah Michelle.
Mama, who bore me? Mama, the angels. No sleep in everything or Bethlehem. Where's Shelley Miscavige? It's Leah Remini. At the end, she goes, "Where's Shelley?" I love Leah Remini, y'all. Don't get me wrong.
I do.
Love me some Leah Remini.
But they are not the same person. But
I will not have fucking J-Lo at my fucking wedding.
Fucking still wedding. Love that.
They're best friends.
They are. And so they did Spring Awakening the year before, and they didn't cut anything. And so.
Wow. That's a very understanding audience.
Well, it's Palisades. Fucking yeah. Judd Apatow is there watching his daughter. Like, it's Palisades High School. And so. But the next year they did Chicago, and I was watching just high school girls wearing bikinis with like those sheer mesh things over them, just dancing and writhing on chairs. And I was uncomfortable.
I don't know if that's the best show to do for a high school, but again, I think most drama programs, I think they do things to please the parents a lot of times and put on a great production to raise money. And I speak from a place of privilege, but that's not what it's about. But I think there's a lot of shows you can teach things to with kids. I don't know if Chicago is one of those. But, you know, I get it. I think there's some things I think a lot of teachers choose pieces that make the kids happy. And
yeah, that's true.
Yeah. So
there you go.
Anyway.
So
who gives a shit?
Well, get ready, y'all. Poodle's going to New York this weekend, so you bet he's gonna have a Broadway corner when he comes back.
And I am seeing such obscure shit. I was trying to try to see Funny Girl, but Leah Michelle's out that weekend. I was gonna try to see Sweeney, but I'm not paying. It'll go down. It'll go down in price. It's just opened.
What about, is Camelot up yet? I'd like to see that.
You know, here's the problem. It's like a 3-hour show. And I'm not there for very long. And I find the book for Camelot, and even though Aaron Sorkin's rewritten a lot of it, I find it pretty tough. I love the score.
I just would want to hear that music with an orchestra.
I totally agree. I'll probably see it in the summer. Yeah, because it's
you know what though? Do you think that will tour?
Probably. Yeah, it's a big revival, so it'll tour.
I'll see it then.
Yeah, I'm seeing stuff that I can't see anywhere else. So that's
It's gonna be a Broadway corner. It's gonna be an off.
It's gonna
off
be
Broadway
an
corner.
Off Broadway corner. It seriously is. Boy. Y'all, everything is off-Broadway that I'm seeing. Oh, I can't wait to tell everybody. Everyone's going to roll their eyes and say, that's the most pretentious weekend ever.
Yeah, it's going to be bad.
It's Poodle's off-Broadway corner.
I'm going to have to take a gummy before we do that segment.
Broadway corner. No,
it's not the segment right now.
Sorry.
All right.
Lorian's going to his casting call, which we've already done before.
Yeah, I will say Darcy kind of says before with Cicero.
Oh, yeah, Cicero. Sorry.
I'm not going to worry about this because Michelle vetted him, and I'm going to trust Michelle. And I went, good for Darcy.
She's worrying about that. But no, like she's saying that, but that picture of him with a woman sent her over the edge. That was all she needed to break up with him.
Yeah.
Yep. So y'all, Florian is now going to an open casting call. We did this for with Gigi. And all these guys, do you notice that the men are like, they look like they're like, it was, it's very like American Eagle, all American models.
Yes.
And Florian is like sitting going, with his thin European body. What?
Was this set up by cast?
Yeah,
by
totally.
Yeah,
totally.
It totally seemed, yeah. Yeah, he's.
The whole show is set up.
Okay, y'all, this is something, I mean, Poodle, well, you've done some casting. I mean, you've been in some, but
yeah. I've been behind the table
on the other side of casting. I've
been behind the table and been over a table.
Oh God! Say no more.
Not in the same casting sessions usually.
But I've gone to a lot of these, and usually when you go to these, especially a smaller one like this, you're going to go and you're either going to have one of the two things. You're either going to have a group of men that look a lot like me, or are very much my type, or and this usually happens when you can tell they don't know what they want.
Yeah.
They have a small group of men of just everybody's a completely different person. You're right. This was not that. Like five guys all looked the same, and then there was Florian.
And that's why I busted out laughing, and I'm like, could we not have found another one who looked like a 16th century vampire?
No, yes.
And came through a magic mirror.
Probably hard to find.
In Miami, maybe, but... And at one point, they said, listen to your favorite song, blah, blah, blah. He took off his shirt. He was posing. Y'all, Florian can't have, they're like, have fun. Florian's like, I don't know fun.
At one point, he just stares off in the distance and then he lifts one leg up. Like, why does he lift the leg up like a flamingo?
The only modeling he knows how to do is that international dour, like really almost couture where the men have a strange look to them and they usually have a lot of makeup on and everything is
like
severe.
Omega watch ads.
Yes. Like, or I was thinking even stuff that's like even more couture, just with no joy in it.
We don't know anything about couture fashion. So
no,
we
don't
list things.
But Gigi's like, so, Florian, I'm going to have you stay. And they're like two other people. And it's like, Florian's got that international high fashion look. But he needs practice. he needs to try to act like a human being. And
yeah.
Anyway.
So this, there, she's going to have him go out for this $150 casting. And we're
or a
going
half
to
day. That is really cheap.
That's very cheap. Y'all, this is going to, please, I hope it's at like fucking opening of a donut shop. I hope. But this is going to be to see how it goes.
The next thing, they are going on their double date. Stacey and Florian and Darcy and Cicero. And I just
Darcy
love
looks
how
gorgeous on this date. Sorry.
That green thing, it's gorgeous.
She looks gorgeous.
I think the Sylvan twins have that in a couple of colors. Because I think I've seen Stacey wear it. In like white.
I think you're right.
Yeah. Because they only wear their own shit, y'all.
They do.
Did you see Stacey spray Banaka in Darcy's mouth? And she was like, you sprayed in a dog's mouth. She's like,
I love them so much.
And Florian hasn't eaten today. So he's just like, shrimp, shrimp, Sunday shrimps. And she's eating it. And she's like, that's got a lot of garlic. Aphrodisiac. He's like, he's just gnawing on
shrimp. Well, vampires shouldn't be eating garlic.
Well, I think that's an old wives' tale. So, because I have no problem with garlic as a vampire.
Or it's a wives' tale. Or God, vampires aren't
real. Vampire.
Or vampires aren't real. I have to
says you.
This to you.
Y'all, well,
I have to remind
all I know is someone has bitten my neck and taken my blood. So, to me, and then they disappear and turn into a bat. So, I mean, they might as well have. They left that quickly.
Wow.
So, y'all, Cicero's not there. 45 minutes late. Y'all, he's not coming. I'm I'm surprised anyone would let themselves be on a show where they were portrayed this way, this badly. That's why I feel like it was a production who set this up.
Maybe, or maybe he started to do it and went, I don't know if he signed the release after the fact or before the fact.
That's a good question.
Probably before they let him on set for this, they probably got a release.
Yeah, probably. So y'all, calls, there's no answer. And there's like, well, I pick on social media. Guess that was,
well,
there you go.
I don't, you know.
He never did have BD energy. Didn't have big dick energy.
And he had bad breath. Smelled like toe jam.
And y'all, this is their pattern. They're already trying. Darcy can't let herself feel hurt.
And so, Stacy swoops in, and in a good way, Stacy swoops in to tell her, like, you're going to find the love of your life.
You're worth it. You're beautiful.
You haven't met your Matt yet, but you will. You will. You will. You will, Darcy. You will.
In a way, though, it's just toxic cheering on, because you never get to cheer. You never get to hear anything. You never get to feel anything.
No.
Yeah. So, anyway.
I'm reading their great book right now. I just started it. And it's
riveting.
I don't want to get it wrong.
You're off mic.
No. I'm reading a great book. I'm like the two chapters in, but it's by Susan Cain, who wrote Quiet, and it's called Bittersweet, How Sorrow and Longing Make Us Whole. I'm a fan of it.
Cool.
What happened?
Sorry, my computer was unplugged.
Anyway, it's very kind of operating that whole thing of like what Brene Brown's talked about, like the pendulum of emotion. Because you're right. Like if you don't...
You got to feel it.
If you don't feel those feelings, then the pendulum of your emotion swings less. It becomes less wide and narrows. So your joy lessens as well.
And you can't, you have to feel the lows to hit the highs. Yeah.
Cause I gotta say, being friends with Poodle, y'all, when he's happy, he's happy. And when he's upset, he's upset.
It's true.
He feels it. Boy.
Yeah, that's true. Some say unhinged. I feel joy and sorrow.
I say your ex had to buy a whole new wardrobe because you burned his clothes in his lawn.
Well, it's healthy. It's healthy to feel things, especially burning things. So y'all, Darcy is meeting Michelle Boho Chic, and tells her that Cicero flaked, and she's like, "Well, that's out of my control now." Do I wish that Michelle had some better bedside manner here for Darcy? Yes. Especially since she's paying her as a client. And so it is almost like she's kind of like shit talking her, even though Darcy's paying her money. I do believe that you should be able to have people who are working with you should be able to be honest with you. However, sometimes honesty goes further and you kind of just wind up being mean. It's the Simon Cowell effect.
Yeah.
You know? So she's like, well, she mentions the picture of the woman who she saw, and she's like, well, Cicero brought the optics that, you know, on your Instagram that he didn't really like you dressing this way for, he probably wouldn't like the way you were dressing like this way for other men. And y'all, that's all Darcy needed to hear. And she went, you know, that's the opposite of what she said. He said to me, he liked it. And going back, if you watch that again, he wanted to talk about it. And she was like, thanks, I like it. Like,
no, he said, but they showed the clip of him saying, though, he said on her Instagram, he said, I like it. Because interesting. I watched it, and the clip they showed was him going, "Oh, your Instagram." And Darcy even kind of went like, kind of like in a, she said, "Oh yeah."
Well, let me clarify.
Well, hold on, let me finish. He went, and then she said, "Oh yeah," and then he said, "I like it."
He had to say something. That's why. He wanted to say something else.
Should have brought it up. Yeah,
I agree. But they were meeting for the first time.
But to me, he could have said, she said, yeah. And he could have said, boy, you got some racy. Well, like, she allowed for that.
I'm not defending him here. I'm saying that's what
he had a problem with. You are either. I'm saying, though, I think I disagree with you when you said Darcy completely, like, said that's not what he said. I agree with what Darcy said. No, that's not what he said.
She did say that. I agree with you. She did say, I'm saying that he when he said that, he obviously didn't mean it.
Yes. Yeah. He was. Sure. Yeah.
He saw her be uncomfortable, and he said, "Oh, I like it," but and there was never a follow up.
We got the when we in our y'all you Miami sissies came at us, and y'all pretty much it was unanimous that based off of this guy's Instagram and all that, y'all were like, "This guy's a fucking tool." Even before we. You all were like, he's a Miami tool. A lot of you, some think you said that you thought that was his car. It was about half and half. Some people said it was. A lot of people thought he rented it.
Yeah. Could have been either. But Darcy says, I'm expressing my
godliness. We said that at the same time.
My godlessness. Godlessness.
That's what I said.
Not a
I
word.
Just couldn't hear it with my Darcy. My goddessness and my beauty.
And then Michelle says, well, it's inappropriate. And this is where I just went, you know, you're kind of, this is not good.
When she said that, I thought, what's inappropriate by what standards? And because if you're going to come for our queen, come correct. And to me, I thought, you know who Darcy is. Like, one of these reasons these guys want to date Darcy is because of who she is in the brand that she's a reality star. Like, come on.
She does bring up, she's like, on the date, he actually did bring up your alcohol consumption. And Darcy went, well, he bought me all those drinks.
Not familiar. What do you mean? Yeah, sure. I've done a cameo a couple of times with a little Chardonnay. Nobody noticed.
And I think it's hurtful to say that to Darcy, especially when she says to him it was a red flag. And to Darcy now, it feels like this woman is chastising her about not behaving the right way for Cicero and almost making it Darcy's fault. And
well, this is what I really enjoyed Michelle. But this, I think, if you're going to be a matchmaker, you cannot have, it's like being a therapist, as you know, being a teacher. If you really want to help people, you got to take your ego out of the equation. And this woman is upset, and she's actually passively, aggressively defensive. Because when Darcy says, when Darcy said, you know what? She's like, I didn't want therapy. She's like, I feel like she didn't say by her, but she said, I feel like I'm being disrespected by him. I think he's telling you lies. And she said, I think I need to, you know, we need to move on. And I'll just do and find a match by my own right now. Maybe this matchmaker isn't working out. And Michelle said, you know, I'm sorry to hear that. And that should have been it. That should have been the end of the conversation. Not this, you need to go to therapy bullshit.
Right.
Because that was just like you're trying to make Darcy feel like shit.
No, and she was, now she was just weaponizing what she had to make Darcy feel bad. Yeah, I agree. When she said, Darcy, look at your failed relationships. The common denominator is you. That's not. Yes, it might be true, but it's also the people she's chosen. It's not the common denominator is the common denominator is always you in the relationships. That's obvious. But to say, I don't think Darcy ever thought that she had no stake in the problems with her relationships. That's what I'm saying. I think
I agree.
It's a ridiculous thing to say.
It's because you're right. That is a blind squirrel just found a nut. You're so right. Cause you're always the common denominator in your own relationship.
It's a zero sum game to say that you're the common denominator because you're basically in that way. You're saying it was all you're the problem. It's me. Hi, I'm the problem. It's me. You're the problem. And these guys were victims of it. And it's not fair.
It's not fair because Michelle never answered. Darcy said earlier in the episode, Darcy even said, I know I'm not exclusive with Cicero, but Michelle's rules are for the matchmaking is that you date one person at a time. Yeah. And Michelle, she kind of apologized for that, but she said, well, I can't control him. But I went, but yet you're trying.
It was obviously she was siding with Cicero and saying Darcy did something wrong. Yeah.
Look, y'all, Darcy is a lot. Some of us are a lot in life. And
not familiar.
There is someone in this life that thinks you are not a lot, that you are just enough. So
not just someone. A lot of people.
Yes, a lot of people. A lot of people think you are just enough.
There are lots of people out there for you. You just have to meet lots of people to do it.
Yes, I meant someone as many someone's, but thank you for clarifying. Because,
y'all know I hate that somewhere out there's one person out there for everybody.
Someone tells you they're a lot, you can say, no, I'm not a lot. You're too little.
You're not enough.
You're not enough. Bye.
So, bye. Anyway, y'all, that's all she wrote.
Don't you come for Darcy.
It's not that what Michelle was saying was factually inaccurate about Darcy's dating style. She's been the most real with Darcy. However, it got to the point where you have to treat Darcy in a better, like, you should know how to treat your clients well to not shame them. And that's what it started to feel like.
Yeah, because does Darcy need to go to therapy? Yes.
100% yes, besides the one therapy session that she had.
Yes, I think therapy would be really fucking great for her. But...
Do you think she'd ever listen? Do you think it would get through her skull?
I think she would. I think the thing about Darcy is that she... once she gets to know someone, at least her friends, she does take her friends and her sister's advice. Like when they give her advice, sometimes she'll take it. So I think it would take her a bit. She would have to really get to know her therapist and build a rapport. Yeah. But yeah.
Wouldn't want to be that therapist.
Probably Darcy.
A lot of work.
The thing is for Darcy, Darcy needs to probably have a male therapist and not a female.
That's a good point. Because she's going to, a lot of times she'll compete with women.
She'll compete and she'll probably, I mean, hopefully she'll end up falling in love with her therapist and then they can work through that. That'd be great for her.
Wow. That's the show, y'all. Wow. I love it you were suggesting that, but in a way I can see how that would work. And then that could be probably one of the most reasonable, safe relationships she's ever had with a man.
She could go through falling in love with someone and then breaking up with someone in a safe, healthy way.
I see where you're going. I just think that's totally fucked up that it has to happen that way. Because as soon as you said it, I went, wow, that's true, but God.
Y'all, sorry, this was a long show, but we, I guess, had a lot of things to say.
We had to talk
episode.
About playing the part with George, the Oscars.
Who else knows? All right, everybody, that's the episode. If you are just walking around this world and you think you're too much, like Poodle said, there are many people out there for
there
you,
are
right,
many
Poodle?
People. And you don't have to, and you know what? They don't have to be with you for life. Like I've said before, a year is a wonderful amount of time. 5 years is a long time. 10 years is better.
And if you want to find those, maybe, if you want to find those people, Poodle, how do you do it?
You walk right into the Manifest Bar and Grill and manifest it.
Smells like garlic in this
bar. Order the Manifest Special.
Lord help the mister who comes between me and my sister. And Lord help the sister that comes between me and my man.